Let us pray. Bless us, God. Bless us in your love. Bless us as we ponder your word. May your word take root in our hearts and in our lives, that your word would challenge us and change us and transform us and make us anew to be who we are really meant to be, in Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
I have to tell you, 30 years in, there was a time, actually, about less than a year in, I was wondering if I'd make it 3 years, honestly. I've had one of the great gifts of the past 30 years has been that I have had wonderful people in my life. And I, you know, of course, Janice and I have been together since seminary and great stuff. But I have had wonderful parishioners who have helped me learn how to believe. And I have had wonderful friends in ministry who have been supportive. I have more friends than I deserve, actually, but that's another story. And I've had mentors. You know, that I've been so blessed in the past 30 years that there have been people who have helped me learn what it means to live into this gospel life. And one of those mentors was an older pastor who was actually a parishioner of mine. You know, it's sort of funny. Sometimes it's very humbling to be a pastor to people who are so much wiser than you. So I had this parishioner, and he was an older pastor. He was retired, and he was well in his 80s, and his health was failing, and he was shut in about half the time. And I would go in, and he loved to just help, you know, teach me things. But there was a topic of conversation that would occasionally come up, and it was, if I could preach one more sermon. And it was what he would preach if he had one more time. And so we talked about this for a while. It went on for a few months, and I finally said, well, why don't you preach that sermon? And he said, well, I never know on any given morning if I can get out of bed. And I said, well, let's just take that chance, but preach it. So he did. And I will add, the text that he chose was the story of the prodigal son. And he said he really wanted one last time to preach that gospel. And he did it, and it was beautiful, and it was his final sermon. And I have to tell you what a great gift it was to know that I got to hear that. But it also got me thinking, I've been thinking ever since, and this has been a really long time that I've thought about this, if I were to preach a final sermon, what is it that I would want to say? And if you had asked me a year ago, I actually would have had a different final text. And if you'd asked me 2 years ago, it would have been a different final text. So I realize, you know, hit me on a given day, and I might have a different final sermon. And the other part of it is I thought, well, why wait until, you know, I might never get a chance to give that final sermon if I wait. So I thought I'd do it now. But I'll do it again next year. So this is my first annual final sermon. But I am going to give you one other challenge, one thought. If you were, by the way, everyone here, you may not know this about yourselves, but everyone here, every one of you has a sermon in you. You realize that. You might not know how to preach it, but every one of you has a sermon in you. Maybe more than one, actually. You know, you might have 1,500. But just notice that every one of us has one sermon in you, at least. And if you were to preach, if you were given that chance, what is it you would preach on? I invite you to consider that question. And if you really want to, we are going to talk about that at the adult class in Vacation Bible School this year. And so bring that with you as something to talk about this week, you know, next week when we have VBS. So I'm going to bring this back so that If this were my final sermon, I would be preaching on John 21. And here's why. I believe this one story just captures the heart of the gospel in such a way that it captures everything that I would hope that we would know as the most important things of our lives. But it starts with Peter, this story. And Peter is always one of these fascinating people in the Bible because he's kind of slow to get the gospel. Even though he's one of the first followers of Jesus, and he was pretty bold, Jesus said, "Follow me," and he followed. But what we're given are all sorts of stories in which the disciples miss the point. And this is now the third appearance of Jesus after he was raised from the dead. And the disciples are really, I think, not quite understanding what this means. Because when Mary Magdalene went to them and said, "I've seen the Lord," they responded by locking themselves in a dark room and hiding. Jesus himself appears to them, and Jesus says, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you," and they respond by locking themselves back in the same room so that he has to come back the next week and send them again. And you realize he keeps sending them, and what do? They keep not going. So finally, maybe this is progress. This week they go fishing. And you know why I think they go fishing? Jesus has sent them to bring the gospel, to bring mercy, to bring forgiveness into a broken world. And I think that sounds scary. I don't think they know how to live a resurrected life yet. And I think sometimes if there's anything more frightening than death, it is the resurrection. Because if we allow death to be the final reality, we just get to say, well, someday you die. And that's the end. But if we say Christ has been raised from the dead and we are raised with him, it means that with God all things are possible. And it means that we are right now in the midst of a new creation. And we don't always know how to live into that. And neither did they. So Peter says, "I'm going fishing." And the reason he did that is where Jesus found him originally. And he's going back to what he knew. He's ignoring what he should be doing. And the other disciples do not try to talk him out of it. They say, "Oh, we'll go with you." So that night they go fishing. They catch nothing. And in the morning, Jesus is on the shore, but they don't recognize him. And by the way, any of you ever go fishing for a really long time and not catch anything? How do you feel when somebody says, "How did it go?" And just think of this. So you have this guy right on the shore, and he goes, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" And it's like, he's like, you know, they said no, but you know, they could have said something else, really. And they go, "No. Cast the net to the other side." Yeah, right, like we hadn't thought of that first. But they do. And now they catch so many fish they can't haul them in. And the disciple whom Jesus loved, who is also the author of this gospel, says to Peter, he says, "It is the Lord." And I love what Peter does. By the way, think about this, because he had stripped off for working, and now he puts on all his clothes and he jumps in the water to swim towards Jesus. You do catch how that might make it a little harder. It's foolish, and yet it's beautiful. Because after everything that's happened, Peter still wants to be with Jesus. So they come ashore, and when they're there, there's breakfast. And there's a charcoal fire. And just notice the charcoal fire. Keep that in your mind. But Jesus takes the bread and the fish, and he gives it to them. It is the same words that we had when Jesus fed the 5,000. He's still feeding, just like he's still feeding us. And in the feeding, they all know it is the Lord. Mm-hmm. So after breakfast, By the way, you ever have one of those conversations that you know you need to have but don't want to have? You ever get yourself in that situation? After breakfast, Jesus pulls Peter aside. And the last time, by the way, Peter was near a charcoal fire in John's gospel was when he was in the courtyard of the high priest and Jesus was on trial and he was warming himself. I always think it's great. You know, he's warming himself by the fire, Jesus is on trial, and the bystanders surround him and start asking him, "Do you know him? Are you a follower?" And three times he denies knowing Jesus, standing near the charcoal fire. Charcoal fire again. And Jesus pulls him aside, and the charcoal fire, the reminder of his failure, of his betrayal. And maybe this is the point where Peter expects to get his ecclesiastical pink slip. You know, you're fired. No more discipling for you. But instead, something else happens. Jesus looks at Peter, and he calls him by his birth name. He says, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" I think he means more than fish or fishing or this other stuff. Do you love me more than these? And Peter says, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus says, "Feed my lambs." A second time he looks at him and he says, "Do you love me?" And Peter says, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He says, "Tend my sheep." And then a third time, he says, "Peter, do you love me?" And this time Peter's hurt that Jesus would ask again. And he says, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Mm-hmm. And Jesus says, "Feed my sheep." Now here's what I want you to notice. Before they ever got to that charcoal fire, Jesus had already forgiven Peter. But Peter needed to know that he was forgiven. And just as he had denied Jesus three times, Jesus now gives him the chance three times to proclaim his love. And I want you to notice that in the course of your lifetime, you will never fall so far that you would be beyond God's love. And God's mercy is always greater than our sin, always greater than our brokenness. Mm-hmm. Always. There's something else I want you to notice. That this is Peter being recommissioned, so to speak, to do the work that Jesus called him to in the beginning. And here's what I want you to notice. What are the qualifications for this work? Because you're called too. And it, by the way, it's not perfection. You do not have to be perfect. We already established that with Peter, right? And you don't have to be, you don't always have to get it right, because Peter had a wonderful knack of getting it wrong. So you don't have to be perfect. You don't have to be wise, smart, clever, talented, gifted in the ways of the world. Your qualification to be a follower of Jesus is very simple, that you love him. And in turn, you are called to love his people. Tend my sheep, love my people. That's it. By the way, that's what I've been growing into for 30 years. Isn't that pretty amazing? Mm-hmm. It doesn't get any deeper than that. So there is one more thing in this story with Peter. And Jesus says, "When you were young, you used to go wherever you wanted. But when you are old, someone will put a rope around you and will take you where you do not want to go." Mm-hmm. And he said this to indicate the type of death by which Peter would glorify God. And this is the one more thing. We do not get to follow God on our own terms. And if you follow Jesus, you're going, you know, you've probably already discovered, I mean, I bet you have, at some point you've been led someplace where you did not want to go for the sake of Christ. And if you follow Jesus, you are taking on the way of the cross. Peter had always wanted to set the rules of how he followed Jesus. And Jesus now puts it back where it started. It's on his terms, not on ours. And finally, he says, follow me. And then there is the one other lesson. Jesus sees John. I mean, Peter sees John. By the way, you ever get tempted to compare yourself to someone? And, you know, and this is the disciple whom Jesus loved. Can you imagine? You might have a little bit of jealousy here. And he looks and he says, Lord, what about him? You know, you just told me I have to take a rope and be led where I didn't want to go. What about him? Tell me he has something worse. And Jesus says, what is it to you if I were to say that he would remain until I come again? You follow me. We don't need to worry about judging someone else's path. We just take the path that is our own. And as for John, that beloved disciple, he was the only disciple who actually didn't get martyred. He's the only one who didn't die for the faith. He actually got to die of old age. And he lived long enough to write a gospel, which originally ended in chapter 20. And then he died. And a community had a panic because there had been this rumor that he would remain until Jesus returned. And so they added one more chapter. It was a story that John had told, but it was one more chapter. And it was a reminder that we don't know how long we're going to live on this earth, but our lives ought to be given to the glory of God always. So here it is, 30 years in, and I'm going to share this with you. This is what I've learned. First of all, God loves us first. You know that, right? Before we love God, God loves us first. The disciples went fishing when they should have been discipling, and Jesus finds them. He doesn't judge them. He cares for them. God always loves us first. It, by the way, the other thing I've learned is that if it depended on us, it would fail. But it always depends on God. God's kingdom comes with or without us, but we get to be participants in that kingdom. And finally, this is how we respond. We love God. We love God in Christ. And we love each other. We love one another as he first loved us. And finally, we follow, not on our terms, but on his. You realize what a wonderful thing it is that God has called us into. You realize that we have been invited to be part of a love that changes the world. We together get to be those people who make God's love known. Amen. Let us live into that together.
Amen.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.